So I figured out that those guards in Egypt had to carry the ankh that was calibrated to the frequency of their own body. John Keeley gave me that clue in some of his work.
John Worrell Keeley?
Yeah. And this was his musical dinosphere that he did all this magical stuff with. Magic. He could do absolutely magic. He was a real magician. And to show you how sound and frequency can burn salt water, you might have seen this. I saw this for the first time about 3 years ago, and since then I've never heard of this guy again. And that's what happens to these amazing people when they discover things. So what I'd like to suggest to you is, if you're holding on to anything, a discovery that can change the world and free the world from the enslavement, put it out there, share it with everybody as quickly as you possibly can. The longer you hold on to it, the more you endanger yourself and your family. Put it on the internet, right? Make DVDs, spread it out as widely as possible. So 10 million people know about it in a matter of 24 hours. Otherwise, you're really not doing yourself a great service.
Instead of paying almost $4 for gas, how would you like to run your car on salt water? Now, it may sound crazy, but wait until you see what a local inventor has come up with that could change the world. And as Channel 3's Michael Barron tells us, that's not all he's trying to do.
Retired TV station owner and broadcast engineer John Kansas was not looking for an answer to the energy crisis. He was looking for a way to cure cancer. 4 years ago, inspiration struck in the middle of the night. Why not use radio waves to kill the cancer cells?
The best thing that worked at that time was I could find at 3 o'clock in the morning was my wife's bypass.
His wife, Marianne, heard the noise and found her husband inventing a radio frequency generator using her pie pans.
I got up immediately and thought he'd lost it.
Here are the basics of John's idea. Radio waves will heat certain metals, like gold. Tiny bits of that metal are injected into a cancer patient. Those nanoparticles are attracted to the abnormalities of the cancer cell and ignore the healthy cells. The patient is then exposed to radio waves, and only the bad cells heat up and die. Killing cancer cells is amazing, but John had also stumbled on yet another amazing breakthrough.
You got nothing in there?
His machine could actually burn salt water. John Kansas discovered that his radio frequency generator could release the oxygen and hydrogen from salt water and create an incredibly intense flame.
Just like that. That was inside a car cylinder. You could see the amount of fire that would be in the cylinder. I can put my hand in here.
Put your hand into the beam, nothing happens. Put in a fluorescent bulb and it lights up immediately. At the APV Company Laboratory in Akron, top engineers have checked out John's amazing invention, and they were amazed.
And we saw it go up to 1,500 degrees centigrade, the temperature, and it's incredible.
This simple Stirling engine is running with the heat generated by the flames coming off that test tube. The fuel, nothing more than salt water.
That could be a steam engine, a steam turbine. Could be a car if you wanted it to be.
That's the true American innovator, someone that is not looking for something, he just finds it.
This is the most abundant element in the world, water. And salt water is everywhere. And to see it burn actually gives me chills.
So imagine the possibilities. Salt water is the ultimate clean fuel, a happy byproduct of one man searching for a cure for cancer. In Erie, Pennsylvania, Michael Mara, Channel 3 News.
So why are we still driving cars on petrol or gas? I don't know. This is an immediate answer. Quick frequency converter in your engine and bingo, away you go. It's because somebody doesn't want us to. And those somebodies have very, very incredibly powerful influence over our lives and everything we do. Sound boils water. This is my absolute favorite. And by the way, just what the other thing that I need to point out as well, what that sound frequency does, that gets the water to burn, it also lights up the light. Do you notice there? So you could actually run your entire household on that. Boiling stuff, heating stuff, lighting your house on just the frequency. This is Peter Davy, a New Zealander who died last year at the age of 94. Since 1940, he's been boiling water with sound frequency. The problem is that he's been trying to make millions and millions out of his invention, and it was money and his obsession with money that prevented all of us from getting free energy. And it's always money that's in the way, which we're going to get to. But this guy should have, this is the holy grail for me. You know, how much water do you want to boil? Sound frequency that boils water, resonant harmonic frequency of boiling water. If any of you have the ability to go into a laboratory and reverse engineer this, just boil some water and measure the resonant harmonic frequency of that boiling water, and that'll probably be the frequency that'll boil it. Then you just need to create a device that creates that harmonic resonant standing wave, dump it in the water, and it should boil it instantly. That's how it should work. So if you can do it, go and do it. And tell everybody if you find it immediately, because you'll hear. This is what you'll find here. They're talking, this guy's just discovered the free energy given the world, the Holy Grail, and they talk about a gizmo that can make a nice cup of tea. And then they have to bring in some hick professor who has no clue about sound and resonance and has to completely undermine the guy's lifetime achievement, you know.
A 92-year-old Christchurch inventor claims to have come up with a novel way to make a cup of tea. He's invented a contraption that he claims uses the power of sound to boil water. Beverly Lockhart went to investigate.
It looks like a desk lamp, is cool to the touch, and appears to be doing nothing until it comes into contact with water. 92-year-old former Spitfire pilot Peter Davey claims his invention uses the power of sound to boil water.
Venus, they're a bit baffled how it works. Nobody really knows how it works.
Davey believes high-frequency sonic vibrations emitted from within the silver bulb cause the water to boil. He says the idea came to him 50 years ago when he noticed different saxophone notes caused different household items to rattle. The mains-powered gizmo has experts intrigued.
Never seen anything like it in my life, as they say.
Professor Williamson has his doubts about Davey's acoustic theory and suspects there are two simple electrodes inside the boiler.
It's the conductivity of the water that provides the path for the current and provides the resistance to give the heating.
I'm careful that I don't divulge everything. I'm waiting to get a manufacturer. It's prepared to put some money into it.
And if he does get it on the shelves, he's already got one interested customer.
If I saw one in a shop, I'd buy one, because I think they're interesting. There's a bit of technology, however it is they work.
But for now, Davey is savouring his gizmo's success and sticking to his own unique theory on how it works. Beverly Lockhart, 3 New.
Interesting little bit of technology. And sound levitates. You've all heard this. Ancient cultures talk about sound levitating, and either levitating with their mind, with their thought, or with sound. But until you see it, it's just a thing that you've heard about. So I found this little video clip that's just really important for everybody to see, because once you've seen it, then you know it really does happen. It's not just somebody talking about it. So what's important to note here is that there are two sources of sound, right? And at the point where they cross over, that's where it seems to levitate, the objects. They're levitating like polystyrene objects, which means that the energy used is very low, just like things are light, you know, easy to lift, polystyrene. The higher the frequency, the more the energy. Therefore, if you're going to lift something really heavy, you're going to need higher frequency of energy, and you're going to have to create that high frequency of energy, which means you're not going to hear it. It's going to be beyond your hearing. So when you're lifting something with two sources of sound that cross over and something is levitating at the crossover point and you can't hear the frequency, it'll look like magic, right? Because here you're standing with two sources of something in your hands like this and something over there is busy lifting up. And you can't hear anything, no machinery, nothing, so it's going to look like bloody magic. Also notice when the subtlest, smallest change in the frequency in the sound, how it makes it spin and vibrate and rotate and dip up and down and then stop spinning. So it shows you that you can manipulate it with the sound. Subtlest changes in the frequencies and you can manipulate it that way. Can you see the sources of sound there? One on the left and one on the right. You can tell people that you've seen it, not just heard about it. It's really important. You know, I like to operate on that level. Just, no, I've seen it. I just haven't just heard about it. It's really important. Sound is free energy. Many ancient and many great recent minds have been telling us this, and I'm going to show you some of this right at the end, how much of this energy sound can generate. Nikola Tesla is one of the most famous ones, obviously, and we should have all been driving cars on his free energy and having lights everywhere, and everything should have been running on the Tesla energy. The most important thing that I found, he said in his work, is that the earth rings like a bell, and if you can tap into that sound ringing frequency of the earth, you can use it as an infinite source of energy. It's what he did with that sound ringing of the earth that is so amazing. I think this is most likely what he did, and many, many more people are starting to see the same thing. He used the sound frequency of the earth, he brought it up to the top of the Tesla Tower on Long Island, and that's where he made the magic. That's where he converted it to this other form of energy that everyone's looking for and could be beamed instantly anywhere in the world,
except
to be used.
Except you can't put a meter on it.
Except you can't put a meter on it, quite right. And that's why they
didn't
broke it down.
That's why it
so
happen.
There's an interesting picture of his tower if you haven't seen it before. And then on the right, the famous Tesla light bulb, the wireless light bulb that you just pick up in your hand and it lights up. Picks up the energy from your body and gives you light. In fact, he also had those that you could just walk into the room, it'll pick up your energy from your presence near the light. I don't know what you would do if you want to go to sleep, but let's not worry about that problem now. And there he is, holding his light.
He put it in a box.
This is how we're shown the ancient civilizations looked. And these primitive people got together and they had a board meeting. And they said, what shall we do to really impress future generations? And one guy at the back end said, hey, let's build really big, impressive structures out of big stones that are really difficult to move. That'll really freak out the future generations. They all said, hey, that's a great idea. Let's do that. They'll wonder how we did it. And then they got together and they roped some pulleys and they built the most important structures in the world in ways that we don't understand. And that's exactly how it happened, right? And I believe that these guys in the past did these things because they could. It was easy for them. The reason why we don't do it today is because it's difficult for us. We don't know how to do it. So clearly they knew a whole lot of stuff that we have no clue about. Just reverse those things, you know, the attitudes about what we think about the ancients. And they got these stones and they molded them together in ways that we just marvel at and go, my goodness, they were so clever. Look at these old people, they were so clever. And then they rounded them and they just knew exactly how to do this. Now, you can't do this unless you use some sort of advanced technology like sound frequency to soften them so you can mold them and put them together so they fit. And I've had some really interesting information on this particular trip through the USA and now in Canada of how some of this was done through channeled information and some information that people have shared with me on various stops, how this was probably done through past life regression and channeled information. And it's spectacular because it falls in perfectly into everything we're discussing here. And it's just really beautiful stuff when these things start to fall into place. You can start using the argument of probability from a scientific perspective, and I love to do that because it gets those that don't want to believe you really upset, because the probability factor is in my favor. resonating energy devices. That's pretty much what we're looking at. All these ancient structures had very strong relationships to energy and resonance. This is a beautiful picture of an aerial photograph of Stonehenge, obviously. Now I'm going to very quickly show you how old Stonehenge is. See that one there, lying over there? That's the twin of this one standing up here. It fell over and it broke. And we told, how old is Stonehenge at the moment? What's the average estimate?
2,300 years.
Sorry?
2,300
years, okay. I read somewhere that they now dated it like 7,800 BC. They're really pushing it. Really pushing it. And it's just such nonsense because they just make these things up because, you know, from, I don't know how they, but they do. They make them up and they publish them. So that stone that fell over is the twin of this one standing up. When it fell over, it broke. That's where it broke. I work with stone every day. Any one of you that work with stone every day, you'll know what a fresh break in a stone looks like and how long stone takes to erode. This is one of the hardest stones in the world, Sarsen stone. When this stone breaks, that erosion there doesn't even look like the same stone anymore. You've got 2 feet of erosion there, people. On Sarsen stone, I'm sorry, the geology does not lie. We're dealing with something that's millions of years old here, not a few thousand years old. The erosion tells us. It's very, very simple. This lintel is one of the ones on top. Look at the crack through this lintel. The lintel must have happened after it was put in place. Not before. They wouldn't have built the thing with the crack in the lintel. So the crack occurred after it was put in place. The erosion around the lintel is spectacular. That's about a 10 centimeter gap in there. Once again, indicating extreme age. The geology will not lie to you. So, you've seen physical evidence. Stonehenge is millions of years old, not just a few thousand years. How that is possible, I don't know. I'm just pointing out the obvious facts to you. Why it's still standing there, I don't know. So next time somebody tells you Stonehenge is a few thousand years old, tell them to take a hike. And not only is it spectacularly old, but this acoustic resonance measurement from Stonehenge tells us that it's very specifically and intelligently built. You're not going to get these beautiful symmetrical interference patterns from something that is accidental. And we know we're dealing with some advanced knowledge and technology with sound, acoustics, harmonics, and so forth. And the same goes for the Great Pyramids. Carmen Bolter here from Canada, she's a huge proponent of the pyramids being sound resonating devices for generation of energy. She goes even further. She suggests that that the sound resonance was created from flowing water that used to flow under the pyramid. So the sound source resonance came from water. Isn't that an exciting discovery? From water? Since water is linked to the creation of all things in our solar systems, now it's creating the sound resonance that comes out of the pyramids as well. You get some seriously intelligent power coming out of those pyramids. And Christopher Dunn, with his study and his Giza power plant theories, is spectacular information. What I discovered when I looked at his work is, you know that in one harmonic resonant octave there are 13 notes. 7 whole notes or 7 white notes and 5 black notes, right? If you look at this, and so it's the 12 notes and the 13th note is the end of the octave and that masks the first note, right? So you got the 5 black notes. Look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the King's Chamber. What are they connected to? By this stone over here. Or this passage that links them. But I think it is originally probably a stone. I don't know. Look at what it connects it to. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 stones over there. 7 layers and 5 gives you 12. This is not by accident, people. I think there's stuff so deeply encoded in this. When you get this thing resonating and it starts to create huge amounts of energy or resonance, this is what it'll probably look like, giving us huge amounts of energy. And if you think that the pyramid is no longer giving us energy, you'll be mistaken, because just because you can't see it doesn't mean